Coming up on the Hilton Head News, a South Carolina man dies after the mortar-type firework he tries to ignite explodes as he holds it against his chest. Also ahead, details on the town ordinance that bans texting while driving. Stand by, the Hilton Head News is next. Welcome to the Hilton Head News. I'm Allie McNair. Plans to dredge Harbortown Yacht Basin and three Sea Pines waterways are moving forward. That's because, according to the island packet, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers signed off on the permit to do the work last week. The South Island Dredging Association has begun soliciting bids from contractors to do the work. The selected contractor will also need approval from state as well as federal regulators. An Ohio man drowned Friday while swimming in Calabogie Sound on Hilton Head Island. According to the Beaufort County Sheriff's Office, 69-year-old Bob Marn was wading in the water with his girlfriend when he was pulled under by a rip current. Marn's body surfaced a short time later. Shore Beach Services lifeguards and emergency responders with the town of Hilton Head Island Fire and Rescue attempted to resuscitate Marn but were unsuccessful. He was pronounced dead at Hilton Head Hospital. According to the county coroner, alcohol was not a factor in that drowning. Here's a look at what's happening around the state. A federal judge has dismissed a state prison officer's lawsuit against cell phone companies. That news comes from the Post and Courier. Robert Johnson, who worked at the Lee Correctional Institution in Bishopville, was shot 6 times at his home back in 2010. Prosecutors say the attack was orchestrated by inmates using illegal cell phones in prison. Johnson's attorney said cell phone providers could jam cell phones used by inmates. Johnson had named 20 cell phone companies and a cellular tower company in his lawsuit. His attorney says they will ask the 4th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals to reinstate that lawsuit. Well, no one intentionally cast a 2012 ballot in South Carolina by using the name of a dead person. That was the finding by the State Law Enforcement Division, or SLED, which provided its conclusion within a report obtained last week by the Associated Press. Last year, Attorney General Alan Wilson called for the investigation after an analysis by the State Department of Motor Vehicles determined that more than 900 people listed as deceased had also recently voted. But SLED says most of those issues were the result of clerical or scanning errors. Only a handful of questioned votes were inconclusive. A spokesperson for Wilson said that the prosecutor was pleased with SLED's work on investigating that matter. Well, South Carolina firefighters will be able to get behavioral health support while they're on the job, thanks to a pilot program started by a group of state and national organizations. The South Carolina Department of Mental Health, along with the South Carolina State Firefighters Association, the South Carolina Fire Academy, and the National Fallen Firefighters Foundation is running that program. The program's aim is to prevent firefighter deaths and injuries in the line of duty by providing firefighters and their families with counseling and psychological support. The program was developed as a result of the National Foundation's efforts to assist firefighters after 9/11 and Charleston SOFA Superstore fire back in 2007. The program will be launched in 5 areas of South Carolina, before being rolled out statewide. A Traveler's Rest man has died after a firework exploded in his hands on July 4th. The Greenville County Coroner's Office says 54-year-old Robin Smith died on the way to the hospital Thursday night. Bystanders say Smith had been shooting fireworks off in his yard. A mortar round type with a 4-inch opening at the top failed to ignite. Investigators say Smith took the firework out of the ground and used a pocket knife to install a new fuse. Witnesses say Smith was holding that firework against his chest when it exploded. Well, the National Republican Congressional Committee has hired strategist Rich Dunn to serve as its battleground director for the 2014 cycle. Committee officials told Politico that Dunn will add weight to the House GOP's senior political team as Republicans defend their majority in the midterm elections. Dunn is currently the chief of staff to South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. It's reported that Dunn will run the NRC's Independent Expenditure Program for 2014, a powerful strategic role in the battle for control of the House. Now, when we return on the Hilton Head News, B.J. Frazier will have details on when the ban on texting takes effect on Hilton Head Island. Don't go away. here at the top of the Harbortown Lighthouse with Nadia Wagner. She's the lighthouse keeper. Nadia, this is a Hilton Head icon, but many people don't realize it's so much more.
It is, Debbie. The view is so thrilling. Many people don't realize you can climb to the top. We've had many marriage proposals, even weddings. You can shop at the top for gifts you won't find anywhere else and wave to friends and family on our live webcam. It's the high point of the Lowcountry.
You do not want to miss this view. What's the admission cost, Nadia?
It's only $375 per person and kids 5 and under are free.
Make this a must-see while you're here on Hilton Head. Thanks, Nadia.
Thank you. See you soon.
It's time for Hot Off the Press with B.J. Frazier of the Hilton Head Sun. Hi, B.J.
Hi, Allie.
News as far as texting while driving here on Hilton Head Island. Tell us about that.
Sure. The Hilton Head Town Council recently passed an ordinance banning all texting while driving, which obviously is a smart move to make because we know the dangers of distracted driving. And now the ordinance, although it's in effect immediately, will not be enforced by the Sheriff's Department. Sheriff Tanner saying he wants to make sure his officers are educated and up to speed on how to handle it. Now, the fines are going to be $100 for first offense and then ranging up to $300 per offense. So don't text and drive on the island.
All right. Now, you know, everyone agreeing on how to do things when it comes to construction or revamping property can sometimes get a little tricky. How are plans progressing over at Sea Pines for the Sea Pines Beach Club?
Well, since the beginning, when the Sea Pines group announced they're going to redo the beach club, there's been a controversy about the number of parking spaces, and the town went ahead and approved the $10 million plan to build the new facility and also the parking and so forth. But there's a group of 27 Sea Pines residents that have brought an appeal to the town saying, wait a minute, you used the wrong rules to set the number of parking spaces. They claim there should be at least 200 spaces, and the town has approved 158. So we'll see where that goes. It comes up against the at the Town of Zoning Board of Appeals in August, and it should be interesting.
Well, BJ, before we let you go, how about some good news out there on the island?
Yeah, absolutely. The Hilton Head Public Swimming Pool that has been in a little bit risky financial shape the last few years has just received funding nearly double of what they had last year. It's going up by $75,000. Now, they will be using that for more affordable programs for the residents, as well as scholarships and so forth. As you know, their Wing Fest that the last couple of years has been rained on and hasn't made the kind of money they need. So this gives them a better stream of steady income, and it'll be better for everybody.
Well, B.J. Frazier, the Hilton Head Sun, as always, great to have you on here on the Hilton Head News. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Allie.
Charlie Clark, Vice President of Communications for the Hilton Head Island Bluffton Chamber of Commerce, joins us on the Hilton Head News. Hi, Charlie.
Hi, Allie.
Well, nonprofits, really, they are challenged differently than other businesses, but you do work with them, the Chamber does. Can you talk about what kinds of things you need to look at when you address the needs of nonprofits?
Absolutely, Allie. You know, nonprofits, we do have a lot of members that are nonprofits, and their needs are different. You know, recent studies showed that because of the cuts happening right now with government grants and that type of thing, that one of the hardest hit cities, private donations would have to come up about 66% just to get back to normal. So a lot of nonprofits are facing challenges. It's a whole new normal when it comes to our economy. So we're going to be doing some upcoming seminars with SCORE, the Service Corps of Retired Executives, to help some of our nonprofit members and others through that.
Well, when you talk about doing some workshops, what kind of topics would you have addressed for nonprofits?
Well, SCORE, the Service Corps of Retired Executives, they're going to talk about everything from your board, how that makes a difference in your organization, and a lot of the fundamentals for nonprofit management, a lot of fundamentals for fundraising as a nonprofit in today's economy. What does that look like and how do you do it? Hopefully it's going to be something very productive for our nonprofits, and SCORE has a lot of knowledge to impart in that area.
Yeah, and also I would imagine, you know, it's very competitive for nonprofits here on the island and beyond in the Lowcountry. Because how many times can you ask the population that exists here for financial donations. So it's got to be competitive.
Absolutely. You know, it's a very generous and giving community. That's obvious. But, you know, as a chamber, we have over 70 members who are nonprofits. Do a lot of different things for them to kind of garner them exposure and help them network. And things like this seminar series that we're doing now hopefully can help those nonprofits and help them understand what's happening today and how they can compete and what needs to happen.
So you actually look at it as a chamber at highlighting nonprofits and their work, too, in the Lowcountry?
Absolutely. You know, as a chamber, we often highlight our nonprofits in our chamber business newsletter, Chamber Business Monthly, as well as each time we do a business after hours, charities have the ability to do what we call a charity partnership. So they can come to business after hours, get the word out about their organization, what they're all about. You know, often when it comes to nonprofits, exposure is half the battle. Just making sure people are aware that you're there, aware that the need is there. And in this generous community, lots of folks step up to help.
Well, you know, you always talk about making those connections, business to business. I would assume nonprofit to business, nonprofit to other chamber members is really important.
You know, it might be even more important for nonprofits when it comes to networking. That's why we have those opportunities for them. This seminar series offered by SCORE and by the Chamber is a six-part series. It kicks off on July 11th. So anybody interested in learning how their nonprofit organization can be more successful, it's a great seminar for them.
Well, Charlie Clark, Vice President of Communications for the Hilton Head Island Bluffton Chamber of Commerce, thank you so much for letting us know about this upcoming opportunity for nonprofits.
Thanks, Allie.
And when we return, we'll find out how one local business is making an effort to help those in Haiti who are still struggling to recover in the aftermath of that massive earthquake that struck back in 2010. Also, we'll find out about helping those who go hungry here on Hilton Head Island. We'll be right back.
The Westin Hilton Head Island Resort and Spa is celebrating its grand renewal. Relax and unwind at the totally renovated resort featuring new pools, lush gardens and courtyards, guest rooms, ballroom, main lobby conservatory, and more. Enjoy family fun on the beach, improve your game with unparalleled golf, indulge your senses with newly inspired Lowcountry cuisine in our refreshed restaurants, including Oceanfront View 32 and Barony Bar, and rejuvenate at the Heavenly Spa. Stay for a night, a weekend, or more at the Westin Hilton Head Island Resort and Spa. Be well. Be Westin.
Reverend Dr. Nanette Pearson joins me now on the Hilton Head News. She is with the Sandalwood Food Pantry and is going to let us know more about that. Dr. Nanette Pearson, thank you so much. It should be Sandalwood Community Food Pantry. How did it get started?
Well, when I came down from New Jersey to relocate, I made a decision that I just needed to feed the children. And so I went about seeing how I might be able to do that. And I made so many calls. And I finally contacted Second Helpings. And they said, Nanette, Sandalwood Terrace Apartments really could use your help. And so I went there and I spoke with the manager, met with the Beaufort Housing Authority, and they were kind enough to give me apartment 121. And we began with five families on February 17, 2009. Today in our new location, we serve 596 families.
Wow, where is the new location?
Our new location, and hopefully we'll be able to be there for a bit, is at 8 Hunter Road. And it's a warehouse facility, but it has a little office and it has a bathroom, which is a real blessing. We didn't have a bathroom in the other two garages.
Now, where do you get food for the pantry to give to people?
Quite a few places. I'm an agency with the Lowcountry Food Bank, which is in Charleston, so I'm able to pick up my USDA product because I'm USDA certified since I began, and that's been wonderful. So whenever we run low, I can always go there. But our number one partner is Second Helpings. In fact, just this Friday, the fellas delivered 1,200 pounds of incredibly wonderful food, so everyone was celebrating.
Oh, that's fantastic. Who is it, though, that you're serving?
All right. Well, I started at Sandalwood Terrace Apartments, so I mostly served the Sandalwood Terrace residents, the Hilton Head Garden residents, and then the Oaks residents. And then it started there and got bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's really anybody in Beaufort County, but it's mostly Hilton Head Island. But I have never turned away anybody. There have been people who've taken buses to me from Hardeeville, I will never turn away anybody who's hungry, ever, ever.
And you mentioned that you distribute the food. You mentioned that you do partner with another agency, but how is it that you distribute the food?
Yeah, well, we like to do it as a free choice pantry. And so I always think, you know, a lot of our clients don't get to have a lot of choices in life, and that's a luxury. So when they come, I don't care how long it takes. If they want to stay 3 minutes and decide if they want broccoli or spinach, that's okay with us. So they come in, they gather together outside, and it's not just about, I have to say, our mission is really to nourish the bodies, minds, and spirits of all who hunger. And our people come not just for food, but for nourishment of spirit and mind and just community. So we gather, and we actually always give thanks to God before we begin to distribute. And then they come in, the disabled and the seniors, and we go in a nice line very slowly. They choose their vegetables and fruits and pastries, and then their meats and dairies, and it's quite wonderful. It's just like a grocery store, and they feel very empowered.
Can I ask you, if someone listening says, gee, I'd like to volunteer, or I have a community organization that would like to help you out, what do they do?
Well, for instance, last Tuesday, a youth group flew in from Georgia, 20 young people, and they came on their hands and knees and scrubbed the pantry. If anyone wants to see the pantry this week, it looks really sparkling. And that was incredible. They worked for 6 hours, and they're coming again tomorrow. So youth groups come from all over, volunteers in churches. Just about every church on the island supports us, and that in itself is incredible. The Unitarian Church delivers food every single week from their services. Emmanuel Holland, it's a joy to see him. The Presbyterian Church, Dare to Serve group came two weeks ago.
Reverend Dr. Nanette Pearson, I'm sure there are even more people you could mention in organizations that help you with Sandalwood Community Food Pantry. Mm. I want to thank you for your time and letting us know about your organization.
Well, you're very welcome.
It was back in 2010 when a powerful earthquake struck Haiti. Work continues to help those who were affected. And one of those people who is assisting is Adam Kurtz. He's co-owner of Bond Bicycles. It's a new business here on Hilton Head Island. Hi, Adam.
Hey, Allie.
Well, tell me something. Why and what are you doing to assist folks in Haiti?
Well, we started Bond Bicycles to, first and foremost, to try to help with a huge financial deficit in a school that I was fortunate enough to help build 2 years ago. And before that, we went down after the earthquake, and this amount of devastation and the perseverance of the people was awe-inspiring. And coming from Hilton Head, where I grew up my whole life, going down there, the difference was amazing, and it was absolutely life-changing. So anything we can do here to help serve is an absolute privilege.
Yeah, I'm sure the way of life was a huge contrast there, especially after that earthquake, to Hilton Head Island. You mentioned you started the bike rental company to help pay for the school that you helped build in Haiti. How are you going about that?
Well, bike rentals is a very unique industry here in Hilton Head. I don't think there's any place in the world where they do it quite like this. And essentially, we charge $25 a week for a bike rental, and that is the same cost to send a child to school for a month in Haiti. So $25 a week, a single bike rental, is enough to pay for 1 month of school for a single child. There's 200 students at the school. We have 200 bikes. So if we run out of all our bikes for 12 weeks a year, we're able to fund the entire education for a whole year of the students in Haiti.
Well, that's amazing. Now, does all of that money go to that, or you must have to keep some of it for administrative costs or figuring out things accounting-wise and the like?
Yeah. Well, the best I can figure out right now, about $6 from every $25 order goes towards overhead expenses. We're just starting out. We're trying to minimize those while keeping quality as high as possible. So it could go down from there. But on our website, we have a page entitled Transparency, where you can see all of our financial numbers and see exactly what we're doing with our money.
So in other words, if I just want to go to your website and see how it's set up, the structure, and how the money goes to help pay for that school in Haiti or other projects, we'd be able to do that going to your website.
Yes, ma'am. BondBicycles.com. You just go on there. Transparency section has all the information about the financials, and there's all kinds of other information on there about what we're trying to do.
Now, someone had mentioned before you came in that you work with Hope in the Light. Is that how this is all structured through that organization?
Yes, ma'am. Hope in the Light is the nonprofit organization located in Haiti. It's a family-run organization. They built the school. They started the school about 3 years ago, damaged in the earthquake. We rebuilt it. They also have a orphanage built up there that they're currently trying to open right now. And they just do a variety of different things as far as getting nutrient-rich food to people who really need it. And a small organization compared to what's going on down there. But
well, let me ask you this. There are people that live on Hilton Head that already have bikes. I know you probably cater more to people that come on vacation. So if someone hears you speaking and says, I want to do something, can they do that without renting a bike?
Absolutely, they can. Essentially, what we're doing is we are sponsoring all the students who aren't sponsored, which is about 140 of them right now. A student sponsorship is a $25 a month gift given every month on the same day. The sponsorship is broken down to cover all the administrative costs of the school, so it's $25 per student, but the actual donation goes towards the whole cost of the schooling. So anyways, if they wanted to help, they would go on to the Hope in the Light website, which there's a link on our page. Go to the Our Mission section of our page and go to Start a Sponsorship. And you can see the link there, and you can, if you want to donate $25 a month, that would go a long way into helping us.
Well, Adam Kurtz, we appreciate what you are doing, co-owner of Bond Bicycles, and thank you for your time here on the Hilton Head News.
Thank you so much for having me, Allie.
When we come back, Nancy Watts will let us know where we can go for entertainment and more on Hilton Head Island. Stay right there.
Welcome to Brown Golf, where playing here has its rewards. Purchase a 20-round package of golf prior to May 1st, 2013, and receive a full day with yours truly. That's 18 holes of golf, 2-hour mini school, and lunch. To purchase that package, go to browngolfmanagement.com. That's browngolfmanagement.com. Now, let's go humble the golf course.
Nancy Watts is here now to tell us where to go on Hilton Head Island. Hi, Nancy.
Hey there. It's good to be back, Allie.
Well, I know you've got some great ideas for families, especially to keep the kids entertained. Tell us about those.
Well, you know, 4th of July has come and gone, but that doesn't mean a thing on this island because we've got Tuesday night fireworks again. We've got all kinds of things for the babies to do. There's the Tammy Jane. They can go on the Tammy Jane and learn how to shrimp like the real shrimpers do. Because they like shrimp, so they might as well learn how, where it comes from.
And what then, about the crabber, Jay? What do they do there?
Oh, that is so much fun, too. And it's so cute to watch those little boys and little girls just throw their little lines out there with that chicken neck on it and just catch a crab. It's just too cute.
Well, that sounds like fun. Of course, a regular for people that come to Hilton Head Island often for the vacation time is Greg Russell.
Oh, you know what? People call us all the time and say, well, when does he perform? And he performs every night during the summer except Saturday night. That's kind of a changeover time for a lot of people who come for the week. And I guess when you get here on Saturday, you're exhausted and all you want to do is eat and go to bed. But Saturday night, he does not perform. But the rest of the week, he does. And he is so loved.
Well, and you know what? It's nice for him to get one day off or an evening off a week, too.
Yes, he does deserve it.
Hey, you were telling me that there's a lot of good buzz about the production of Shrek. Where is it being produced or up and running now?
Oh, it is. In fact, I've been reading Don Heit's Facebook page, and he just says every night it's just rolling in the aisles. It's Wednesday night through Saturday night, and it's a musical, and apparently getting rave reviews, and it would be a fun thing to go see.
Well, that sounds like a great idea. As always, Nancy Watts, you always have something for us to do here on Hilton Head Island and beyond, and we appreciate your time.
There's always so much to do here on the island. Go have a good time.
Thanks. And we want to thank you for watching this edition of the Hilton Head News. I'm Allie McNair. We'll see you the next time.